Think about all the blessings you had this week, this morning, today, because God is so good.
Yes.
And one of the things, you know, sometimes when you wake up, and it's been happening more and more lately, just certain songs come into your mind. You might have sang as kids, and this was one that we sang as kids. We've come this far by faith. I remember, you know, we would sing that song a lot. We had a youth choir, and then we had the adult choir, and this is one we used to sing out in the congregation as well as up on the platform. Leaning on the Lord, trusting in His holy word. He never failed me yet. And it talks about, oh, no turning around. I love that. No turning around. We've come this far by faith. You know, and I would listen to that and listen to that and listen to that. And one thing that always would, and I'm being honest, always kind of was nagging at me all the years I'd sing his song, where it says, leaning on the Lord, trusting in His holy word, He never failed me yet. That would always bug me. You know why? Because it didn't. That one little verse didn't make sense to me. He never failed me yet. It's almost like, well, one day He might. And I said, no, we take it. He never will fail me. That's what it's about. He never will fail me. Not going to be a yet. We're going to take the yet off. Because He never will fail me. God is on your side. You know, thing about God, He can't lose. He cannot lose. Even if the situation doesn't look good, God can still turn it around. And one of the things, that a verse I'd like to share, a few verses, is in Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. The Lord your God is in the midst of you. A mighty one, a Savior who saves. He will rejoice over you with joy. He will rest in silent satisfaction in His love. He will be silent and make no mention of past sins or even recall them. He will exalt over you with singing. I will gather those belonging to you, those Israelites in captivity who yearn and grieve for the solemn assembly and the festivals, of whom their exile and inability to attend services in Jerusalem have brought derision and reproach of it as a burden. Behold, at the time I will deal with all those who afflict you. I will save the limping ones and gather the outcasts, will make them a praise and name in every land of their shame. At that time, I will bring you in. Yes, at that time, I will gather you, for I will make you a name and a praise among all the nations of the earth when I reverse your captivity before your eyes, says the Lord.
Yeah, amen.
That tells me God's going to turn some things around. You might have been waiting for a long time for things to turn around. And it goes back. We come this far by faith. We've got this far. You know, He's going to take us to the next step. Right. One thing about God that I love, about all the things He's breaking you through, He's bringing you stronger and allowing you to trust more and more in Him. The thing that we seem to do sometimes, when we come into a hard place, we seem to forget that God delivered us over here, and we get to wonder if He's going to deliver us over here.
Right.
Well, it's the same God that was over A that's going to be over B. It's the same God, and He does not want us to forget that.
Right.
That's what I feel about God, and I said it a lot, but I believe it's the truth to where God is. You almost see God's heart is yearning that, you know, if my people would just believe me, that's what it, just believe who I am. Think about that. Think about how good and holy and righteous a God we serve. A God that calls you by name. That God understands the cry of your heart. And He's saying this morning, I want you to know, I rejoice over you. You bring pleasure to my life. You know, today is my oldest son's birthday. And I thank God for him. And you know what, I just remember those times you just sat and you talk. He's the oldest son, and just sat and you talk and you enjoy that time with each other. Because you know what, we tend to always think that tomorrow's going to be here. We tend to think that, you know, I mean, that's why you make schedules and plans, but we don't know. So we want to take this day to tell those that, hey, you know what, I love you. You might not get to say it tomorrow, right?
Right.
So you want to tell them how much you care, how much you appreciate them. And you know, when I see the birthday wishes, one thing, I would always tell them, I want God to continue to bless you and your family. I want God to continue to work in your life. I want God to use you in a mighty way. Because God has a plan for everybody. Everybody. You know, sometimes we kind of look at the clergy that works in the church and stuff, and you got different roles in the church. But some of the best roles in the church are those who just pray.
Yes.
They just pray for our leaders. Pray for one another. I always like the mothers of the church. Because the mothers of the church, you know, when we was growing up, you know, we would tear it down to altar. I mean, there wasn't, you know, there was, if it went to 2 o'clock, that's the way things went. But they would tear it down to altar with you. People would come down and pray with you. Because I think that's so important. I love this church because we share a lot of scripture, but we have people who pray. I love it when somebody comes in and somebody has a need. Let's pray. Yeah. Let's pray. Because sometimes we put prayer off. We'll pray for you generally. We'll pray for it. But it's something when God's people can come up here and together and lay hands on this or lay hands for somebody else. Because that's what God loves, is that unity. Behold how good it is the brethren dwell together in unity. God loves it. I mean, you take a mom and dad, they love it when their family's in unity. When everybody's in harmony. They love that. They don't like the disharmony. They like it when you can all sit around a table and laugh and smile. Because that's my family. And I gotta share this one thing and then I'll go on. But to me, it was a picture what God was showing me about my sons and about how much he loves all of them. One day we was down at Six Flags and I have four boys and two of them went with us and two of them, older and a younger, it's actually older and younger, they went over and go some rides and said, we're going to meet at the stage area, this one place. Well, all of them came except the two I needed. So we didn't know where he's at. So we went and got security and asked him to look for him and stuff. And so the third one come, but I was missing one. And I remember, should I have said this or not? I don't know. I just looked at it that I had to say it. And so God brought me. Now I had three boys, but I had one more that was still missing. And I remember saying this. I said, God, I'm sorry. That's not good enough. Reason is because I have four sons. Mm-hmm. I have four sons. I need them all to come home.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be happy until all of them are here. I have four sons, and that just struck me. And then here he comes. He comes walking down there, and I'm running over there to him. I ain't embarrassed because they're my kids.
Yeah.
I'm not embarrassed. So I run up to him, and I'm hugging and kissing him, you know, and the security's out there. Think you found him. Yeah, we found him. We found him now because I want them all home.
Yeah.
They're all my kids.
Right.
So look at the cry of God's heart. You know, God wants all of his kids to do well.
Yeah.
He loves all of you. Just think. When we talk about that verse, you rejoice when you're singing. It's almost like holding a baby in your arms,
yeah.
You know, and you're singing those sweet songs to them. You know how precious that is? You know what kids like? I know I put a lot of them to bed, but they like that time you spend with them. And, you know, and it's so good to pray with them and let their little hearts, do you have something you pray? And it's amazing. The little hearts, they'll come out and say, I want you to, yeah, pray for my brother or pray for my sister, you know, or whatever the circumstance may be. I want to pray. And you can get them to pray a prayer and get them to seek God and let God. I said, the best gift you can ever give to your kids is the love of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
You can give them all the cars and clothes and all that, but you know what they remember the most? Those times you pray with.
That's right. Amen.
So today, that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to rejoice over God. We're going to remember today how good God is.
Yeah.
How much he cares for you and he loves you, and each day he's rejoicing over you with singing. Hallelujah. So we're going to open this testimony time up because it's always good. All of us have something to praise God for, right? All of us do. And I think it's so important to take that time and if it's no more, just say, thank you, Lord. That's why. Because you know what? We're given all those hours in the course of a day. You think about it. It's 100. You got in a week's time, you got 168 hours in a whole week. 24-hour day, 7 days a week. Wouldn't it be nice to take a portion of that each day and just say, God, thank you. It's so often, and it's nothing wrong with going to God for your prayer request and things like that. It's nothing wrong to ask God. He didn't have an issue with that. But it's also so nice just to go to him and say, God, you know what? I'm coming today. I'm coming. I don't want anything from you. I'm not going to ask no request at this moment. You know what I'm just saying? God, I love you. And I appreciate you. I thank you for all you've done for me. And here I am. Whatever you want to do in my life, I surrender. I surrender my whole life. Because you gave me my life back. Think about where you came from. And I remember being out to Philadelphia, and I was walking, and it was a big church. And we look at the crucifixion, and they got different images. But this was a church on the corner. It had a big cross, and it just struck me, and I thought, that's a good image. It's not a traditional crucifixion, but I thought, no, I think they really got it right, because they had Jesus on the cross like this. So his one hand was up here on the cross, and the other had a dove like this, and he was leaning down like this. It's like, this is what I did for you, but this is what I'm offering for you. Will you accept me? And it just stood out. I'm just standing in the corner. I said, yes, that's it. He's offering us peace. He's offering us love. He's offering us understanding. He's offering us hope.
Yeah.
You know, he's offering that. And he's saying, will you take it?
Yeah.
Will you take it? You want your life changed? You want your life to change into something good and reflect Christ? It starts with accepting him.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, so we're going to start praising the Lord. Someone. Yes.
I praise the Lord for the revelation that he's given us so that this generation is
going to
grow up knowing who they are in Christ and be used mightily.
Hallelujah. That's awesome. I just love it when those little kids understand who they are. I used to go to Kingsway Church years ago, and we went to children's camp, and this one, they come from all over, and one young man, he come from Iowa City, or south of Iowa City there, and one thing that I loved about that kid, he was probably 7 or 8 years old, and we got to talk about, you know, knowing what God wants you to do. He said, Tim, can you know early? I said, yeah, you can know early. He said, I do. God's called me to preach, and he was like 8 years old, and he understood. And he had his Bible out, and I'm telling you what, he was a fireball. He understood that God had called him, and he was serious, but it wasn't just, you know, he understood, because he'd have his Bible out. I mean, some of the other kids would be running around, and boy, he had that Bible out, and he understood, and he would share, because he understood when God changed you, it is like a fire shut up in your bones, because you want to share how good's God been to you. You know, you can't, sometimes, I'm telling, when people say something about God, and some of them might not say something the right way, there's times you know you have to speak up. I remember at I was over DMAC one day, and this young man, he was talking about his grandmother, and I know I shared this before, but he says, you know, Tim, my problem, my grandmother, she trusts God too much. Well, I'm telling you what, you shouldn't have said that. You shouldn't have said that. I can't sit by, that's all right. I said, you never can trust God too much. How are you going to do that? Because you go more and deeper and deeper and deeper. Paul said all the life he had of Christ, all to know him, to know him. So you want to get deeper. You can't know the heights and depths of it all. Somebody that's been living with the Lord 40, 50 years. I remember I went to a church, and there was a young evangelist teaching there at the church, and the older lady of the church, she was sitting by, and she'd been with the Lord for like 40 years. And I remember she said, you know what? He's just starting to know. He's just starting to know. I've been with the Lord 40 years. I don't have it all yet. He's just starting to know. You know, he's just getting there, but he's got a long way to go. Why? Because you learn more about God. He takes you from mountain to mountain. You know, he takes you from glory to glory. You get deeper. Yeah, and that's the way it should be. From the time you get saved, every year you need to get deeper in the Lord. So you start understanding more. You know, that you start maturing in the Lord. Some of those things that used to kind of bother you when you first, you know, nowadays it's like, no, you know what? Because I'm here, like Jesus said when he's 12 years old and he was in the temple and they had to come back and get him. And he said to his parents, don't you know I must be about my father's business?
Right.
Not a smart aleck answer, but a realistic one. Because that's what he was sent. Jesus understood that. I must be about my father's business. And that's what we are here for. You know, because I always wonder, if we get saved, why are we still left on the earth and not taken right out of here?
That's right.
Because God has a purpose for us. Yeah. There's somebody that God wants you to pray for. There's somebody that God wants you to talk to.
Amen.
See, there's certain people I could reach because I'm in the truck and field. And I understand truckers and I understand that life. I can talk to them. You know, you can bring it back. Bring everything down to him. That's why Jesus talked a lot in his life. You know, there's a lot of farming and fishing and stuff. And a lot of the parables had to do with farming and fishing.
Right.
If it was in the modern age, he'd probably talk about computers and cars or something because people can identify and understand it.
Yeah.
And that's what God wants you to do. There's certain people only you will be able to reach.
Because right.
People in your world. Why has God put you in the house that you live in now? In that neighborhood.
Right.
You ever think about that?
Mm-hmm.
Why did he have you go to this car dealer at this place instead of going over here? Because he had somebody. And even if it's all you do is pray for that person, there's some people that it's like your heart pulls toward them.
Yeah.
You know, you may not end up talking to them, maybe circumstances, but you know what? Man, that lady over there, I just feel like there's some needs in there. You know, I can pray for her. We may not ever meet, but there's going to be people in heaven that, you know, you're going to be so glad they prayed for you.
Amen.
There's people that's praying for you clear across the world. God, I want you to pray for this congregation there in Des Moines, Iowa. They might not know anybody in this congregation, but God can put them on your heart and say, pray for them. Because God knows who will pray and whose heart that he can touch and move and say, hey, I know, Lord, I'm going to be obedient to whatever you have me do.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes.
I seem to be so forgetful. You know, I have a little bit of a longing or a difficulty or depression, you know, that something depresses us. And we just seem like wearing it and seem to forget.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Yes, James.
I think every time that you injure yourself, you have to think of more about
He's a very present help.
Amen.
You know, right now, God, that's what I love about him. You know, he's right there. And he understands all the things we're going through. Hallelujah. Someone else. Someone else. Yes, sir.
Came up and it says, know, light or dark. I went, no, that ain't right. So I'm driving, and luckily I came right to a stoplight. You know, God's good like that, right? So then I look down here, it says wisdom. And
Jesus.
I think God's got something for you, too. God wants to give you a man of wisdom, brother.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I just want, he's prompted me to give it to you right here.
Come on.
In front of everybody.
Exactly the right size. Exactly the right size.
God knows your size.
Yeah, he knows your size. Thank you, Eric. Thank you. Thank you for being obedient. It's those things like that mean a whole lot. Because, you know, God was talking to you and you was listening. That's part of prayer. It's not just talking to God. It's listening to what he's saying to you and being obedient. So I'm going to treasure this.
Well, Seth, okay? About a month, so don't
yeah. thank you, God bless you, and I'll always remember that.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You never know. Yeah, Peter.
Well, so started a new job as a lot of people know a couple months ago, but like Joyce Meyer says, you know, sometimes the devil will always attack you in your mind.
Yeah.
She has what she calls mind binding demons, and this week was an especially tough week. I won't go into all the details, but, you know, I want to thank especially Mike and Pastor for praying for me. I mean, I texted Pastor right away and said, you know, I need prayer right now because I'm being attacked in my mind. We get so much information coming in, and my boss is awesome, but I never get to work with my boss. She's in Charlotte. I have a project manager that I work with that's here in Des Moines, and she's very demanding and not always very forgiving if you mess something up. And so, you know, information's flying at me every second. I don't really have time a lot of times to research things. But, you know, as soon as Mike and Pastor both prayed for me, you know, I could feel all of that lift, and I was able to actually think clearly. But, you know, I just need continued prayer because I know this job is the will of God for my life right now. I know that he told me to not focus on doing the work here, but to focus on getting our own business making money.
Right.
And this is just to supply our needs for now.
Yeah.
But, you know, the battle's in my mind. I'm continually, I keep getting defeated there. So I'm first of all thankful for the prayer that I had this week, but also need continual prayer.
Yes.
Amen.
We will definitely do that. Definitely do that, Mike.
I just looked up Meyer, and theoretically going to be released last Friday, but they're keeping him because of the pain situation he's facing. The weird part about it is the healing's manifesting.
Yep.
You look at the wound, and the wound's manifesting. There's new growth and everything all coming in. Where the pain's coming from, I don't understand, but I think it's unseen things that are manifesting that need to be rebuked and dealt with. So we'll just stand with him. I know he has some life issues that he's been dealing with, and I pray that he gets released from those things. The past keeps trying to chase him down, and we just need to get that axe out and chop it off so he can move on and run in the race that the Lord has provided for him.
Yes. Amen. We'll definitely pray. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I want to thank God that my granddaughters are here.
Woo-hoo. Praise the Lord.
And that they get to hear all this good stuff.
Yes.
About
the Lord. Praise
because
the Lord.
This is what will keep them through the week. And I just want to thank God for keeping them.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Yes. That's awesome. Great.
Thank you, Lord.
Okay, would we all stand for prayer, please?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for being such a wonderful God. We thank you that you never, ever give up on us. We thank you, Lord, that everybody that's here today, that we just ask you to put your arms around them and let them know how much you love them. You love them with an everlasting love, the love that has no ending. Because the word says you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending. Your love just keeps going on. In the beginning, God, before we was formed in our mom's belly, you knew us. You have a plan for each and every one of us here today. A plan that gives us a future and a hope. Father God, that we may learn to be obedient when you call us. We may not know where, as they said the other, we may not know where we're going, but we know who's going with us.
Yes.
And Father God, we thank you for the needs that came up today, that you continue to be with Myron, Lord, and Lord, continue as that's manifested, that Lord, I know that in our minds that and Satan loves to get things out of kilter, but we know the Bible said, keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you. And that's what we need, Lord. Lord, we ask you to be with Peter in that job situation. Lord, we thank you for giving the job. We thank you, Lord, for the little different issues that James and his friends and how he can see better now even. And sometimes that's how things work. Because she said all things work together for the good. But those that love God, they're called according to his will and purpose. Think about that. Those that are called, he has a plan. All that the word plan just keeps coming up in my mind. Plan, plan, plan. Because some people, they think, well, God can't use me. Yes, he can. Yes, he can. You are here on this earth for a reason. And that reason is to glorify him. Glorify him with your life. Those circle of friends, those work friends, you can always pray for them. Because you never know where people are in their life. But we serve a mighty God, a wonderful counselor, our Father, who can change any situation. Is there anything too hard for God? The answer is nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Hallelujah. Because the Bible said, for with God, all things are possible. It didn't say some things, a few things. The Bible says all things are possible. We serve a mighty God, the creator, that spoke this world to existence. And that God can speak against all those situations in your life and make them come out so that you will be better off than you were before.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Yes,
God, we lift up our children and our grandchildren.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That their lives, they may be used. No matter where they may be used. That there'll be a light put in them. Hallelujah. A light of glory. So people can see that they have spent time with Jesus. What makes you have that outlet there? You look so different. What makes you not complain? The reason is because I have Jesus and I realize it's time to stop complaining and start proclaiming how good God is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we love you today. We lift you up today. Father God, your word said if you be lifted up, you draw all men unto you. And we're lifting you up today. We're praising you today. And our praise is going to go straight through the ceiling and up to the throne room. Because it's all about you, God. Oh, to know him. To know his goodness and his strength and his truth. That's what it's about. It's about your word, Lord. Your word, and you are the word. So, Father God, we ask you to be with this service. Continue to work in this and change a life. That when we leave this building today, we won't be the same as when we came in here. Because you are a God that can heal. You are God that can deliver. You are God that can provide strength when we don't have any strength. And the Bible said you are the way, the truth, and the life. And we thank you for the privilege to carry everything to you in prayer. We thank you. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Please turn off cell phones, please. Thank you. And let's speak the word from our heart out and with a big voice. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed, renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can I have Eric and Eric come up and take the offering? Got two Erics now. Rest can be seated. Okay, thank you. And Brother Eric, would you say the blessings, please?
Father, we are so blessed and thankful for this day and this church. We graciously humble ourselves before you today. Lord, I can feel that we're going to have a powerful movement through your word today.
Woo!
Lord, bless this offering we're about to receive. In Jesus' mighty name.
Thank you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
saying so many times, this is an honor to all these things. I know you have strengths, and others have strengths, and that's just part of the tapestry. But what Pastor's been trying to bring forth for years now, bringing forth the revelation. Let the Lord bring forth the revelation.
Amen.
Of what he has done.
Yeah.
I thought I'd never see, years ago, I thought I'd never see grandpa's only granddaughters in the aisles of worship. Woo! And I can scream and shout, but guess what? I'm over it. I just want to see grandpa start getting up and shout. Come on now. Hey, grandpa's. Yeah. Woo. This pastor is bringing forth words of revelation. There's a few songs that were ministering Wednesday night here. This is all tied together, church. This is all tied together. Hallelujah. There'll be a time, there's a place, and it's now, where the Lord is bringing forth revelation, opening our eyes and hearts and spirit to things that he's been wanting to do for years and years and years. Lord, so now I want you to get back to your first love. When was it? Where was it that you got that revelation? And we're going to take a journey starting today on some of the things and times that I personally, and I know that many of my brothers and sisters have been, that brought forth that revelation. So the Lord gave a compilation of three, I call them revival choruses. We used to sing choruses back in the day, just the choruses. Y'all remember that?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So just hang on. Just hang on. Just let the Lord love on you. Let the Lord love on our kids and our grandkids. Because there's a generation coming up. Hallelujah. So turn your eyes upon you. Full of his wonder.
Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands to the Lord right now. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Father, we just bless you this morning. Thank you for saying yes to us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being open to our hurts and our pains, our questions, our doubts, and being the answer, Lord, to every situation and to every circumstance, to every question, Lord. You are the answer.
Yes.
We bless you this morning, Lord, for who you are, and we thank you for all you do. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated. Praise God. Thank you, Mike and worship team. Thanks, Tim. Appreciate you, your words, and it's a blessing. Amen. When people have the liberty, praise God, to just let the Lord loose. Hallelujah. Well, thank the Lord. Praise God. Sunday school kids, if they haven't already, may leave. Praise God. Appreciate all your testimonies and sharing your prayer requests with us. We know that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Here's the catch. Power that's in you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God. It's Christ in us. Hallelujah. Amen. So let's get right to the Word of God this morning. We're going to begin with Colossians chapter 2. And we'll read verses 8 through 10. Colossians 2, verses 8 through 10. Last week we were talking about revelation for revelation, light for light. And I don't want to contradict myself, but on the other hand, I want us to be clear that until we're able to really embrace revelation that we have, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense for us to have more revelation. Praise the Lord. Amen. In fact, right now I think most of us have more revelation than we can walk in. That doesn't mean that we won't or that we shouldn't. It just really, it's like anything else in a process. If we just took the natural, where it's a question of intellectual knowledge, you always have to build on the knowledge you have. That's why we have grades K through 12, because they can't teach them everything in kindergarten that they're going to need to learn over the next 13 years, right? And so likewise it is, with the Word of God. And I don't want to make it, a natural thing, but on the other hand, there's parallels in the spirit and the natural realm. And so in order for us to really grow, we need to embrace the revelation that God gives us, and without embracing that, we can't really move on to the next thing. Amen? So that's kind of my outline here this morning, and we'll see how far I can get scattered from that. It's generally not too difficult for me, praise the Lord. So we're going to begin with Colossians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, and beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and powers. Now I just want to draw your attention here to verse 9 for a moment, because we know that Jesus is the fullness of the Godhead bodily, that all the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him. Amen. But what's important based on that scripture is that we are complete in him. It's not how much more information you get over the next X number of years of your life, but it's how deeply we can go into him, how much we can be found in him. Does that make sense? I'm not talking about regimen or routine or rules or regulations. I'm talking about surrendering to Christ, or allowing Christ to live his life through you. Amen? To be found in him is the key. Because if we're found in him, we got all the fullness of the Godhead operating, right? Praise the Lord. So, Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that word conversation simply means our existence or our being is all based on the fact that we are in heaven. We are in Christ. Christ is seated at the right hand of God. We are seated with Christ in that same place, seated together in heavenly places. Amen. So that's considering that we are in Christ. The flesh is not seated, amen, with God. Praise the Lord. But our spirit man, which is born again, which is brand new, which is just like Jesus, is. Praise God. The constant conflict is flesh and spirit. The natural man versus the spirit man. That's the battle. We can call it the battle of the mind, but it's true. Because our mind, amen, is part of the flesh. The intellect is part of the flesh. It has to be renewed to the Word of God in order for it to conform to whatever it is God is trying to do in our particular lives at any given time. Amen? But here's what I've been finding out over the years, especially recently. You know, many know that I'm not a great technophobe. Praise the Lord. In fact, I may be phobic about technology. Praise the Lord. I may have a phobia about it. I don't know. I'm just not really great at computers and all that stuff, and I've still got the flip phone, and I haven't figured all of that stuff out yet, and so I'm not ready to move on to the bigger challenges, praise the Lord. But I do notice that everybody seems to want new revelation, amen, at least it seems that way to me. Most of us, most of the time, want to know what's next, what's now, right? And have you seen the TV commercial where the guy has been out shopping, he's looking everywhere and he's finding the biggest screen TV with all the latest technology and, you know, everything. He can run the computer through it and he can see 50,000 different channels and it's all high definition and everything is great, and he can TiVo and he can Devo and he can do whatever else he can do with a, you know, with all that kind of stuff, and he's all excited and they're just bringing it in and he's just as proud as he can be, and he's looking to see if the neighbors are all watching this big mammoth technical device that's coming into his house. And about that same time, he sees a delivery truck go by. And right there on that truck is an ad for a new TV. And his whole countenance just drops. It's like, there's something newer than what I got. Amen? So, I mean, we don't want yesterday's technology. We don't want yesterday's news. Although, if you think about it, it's all yesterday's news. By the time we get it, it's not news, it's history. But that being said, we want the latest, amen? And that's why you see people walking around with their heads down and they can't get away from their phone or their iPod or their iPad or their next whatever it is, and they're stumbling over things. I was watching one where the people were falling into fountains. They were so absorbed in texting somebody and getting the latest information from somebody. I mean, we just can't stand to not know everything immediately. just see if you're still out there, praise the Lord. I mean, when I was a kid, and I'm not saying we should go back in time and all that, but, you know, they still had pay phones. You had to go find a phone on the street and then hope you had the change and hope that somebody hadn't peed in the phone booth or broke the thing off the hand. You know, I mean, how many of you have been in some phone booths? You know what I'm talking about. They're not all pristine and sanitary and perfect. They're usually pretty nasty. Amen. And so you pick the thing up and you look at it and you go, well, here we go. Is this call really that important that I want to be subjected to? God only knows what petri dish of germs is on this phone thing. So, but nevertheless, that's the way it was. And you just, you know, I mean, you just didn't talk. If you want to talk to somebody, you wrote a letter if they didn't live nearby. If it was long distance. We had people that didn't have a telephone when I was a kid growing up. And if they had one, there was party lines. So you had to hope that everybody else wasn't listening to everything you were saying, or you had sense enough not to say everything that you knew because everybody else would know it as well. Praise the Lord. But people today, they log in and they don't log out. They're just there. They're on all the time. Praise God. God forbid we find out about something an hour after it happens, as if we were going to do something about it in the first place. But my point is this. The same dynamic takes place in the church. The same kind of mentality, by and large, we want the new stuff. And we want new revelation. And we say things like, you know, God hasn't been talking to me lately. And what we really mean is God isn't giving me the direct hotline of insider information that I'm looking for. So that I can be the bearer of revelation. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. If I sound like I'm being mean, I'm not really. I'm just trying to be honest. Praise the Lord. So we want new revelation, but we don't embrace what we already know. Sally and I were talking the other day, and I said, we were talking about revelation, and I said, how about this one? The just shall live by faith. How many hundred years old is that? Well, actually, it goes back, you know, I mean, obviously to the time that the scripture was given by the Holy Spirit, but the revelation of that was Martin Luther.
Right.
And I don't know about you, but I'm not always walking by faith. Sometimes I'm walking by sight. Sometimes I'm listening to the lies of the enemy. Sometimes I'm seeing the lies of the enemy, and I'm not really trusting completely in God. Or sometimes, you know, you just wake up in the middle of the crisis and realize, hey, this is a crisis. I need to be spiritual here. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
I mean, anybody ever find yourself in the middle of something before you realize you had any control over it?
Yeah.
And you start backpedaling and thinking, okay, what do I got to do now? I mean, I know I have authority here. Maybe I need to exercise it. But my point is this. We've had revelation of the just shall live by faith for hundreds of years now. And very few of us are really walking in it in a consistent way. So this is what I'm talking about. I'm not talking that I don't want God to reveal revelation to me, but what I really am saying is I want to live in the revelation that I already have. I want to experience the fullness of the revelation that God's already given me before I get all excited about the next thing. Because there's so much power in what we already have that we're not walking in that we will lose so much by trying to jump to the next thing without having understood or embraced and really experienced what God has already given us.
Amen.
Amen? I just think a lot of times we get the milk and the meat confused. In fact, it's the simple gospel that keeps offering up deeper wisdom if we will keep pressing into it.
Come on.
Amen. That's why Paul comes full circle at the end of Philippians 3, because it's meant to keep us from getting ahead of ourselves. Philippians chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not against revelation. I'm seeking the Lord all the time. I want to know what God's saying. I want to know what he's saying to me, to the church, what he's saying, amen, in terms of how we can operate. But I just find it kind of childish for me to come running to God for the new thing when I haven't even addressed the last thing.
Come on.
It's like, have you ever given your kids or grandkids or something a toy? They play the 5 minutes, throw it off in the corner, and now they're looking for something else to play with. Or they want to play with their sibling's toy.
Yep.
Not because they don't have one. They just want the one they don't have, praise the Lord. They want somebody else's stuff, amen? So let us, therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God will reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Amen. So Paul's basically saying, oh, before we talk anymore, let's remember what we've already got. Let's remember what we've already attained before we're reaching for the next thing to attain. Amen. Let's remember the main thing is the main thing.
Yes.
Let's hold on to what we have been given. Praise God. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. And I'm telling you, I can say this with some assurance, that if you'll walk in the revelation that you have, before you know it, you'll find you have greater revelation.
Come on.
It's only in the revelation that you have that you can actually move on to greater revelation.
Come on.
So if we're not willing to embrace or to experience the revelation that we have, we're going to have problems moving into the next. Amen. So looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Simple enough.
fix your eyes on Jesus. Mm-hmm. Keep focused on Jesus. 2 Corinthians 3:18. You don't have to go there, Mike, but for the sake of time, but it's just, we've talked about it plenty. It's beholding, it's as though we're beholding ourselves, our image, in a glass. And the more we see Jesus, the more we are transformed into that image of Christ. We're not transformed into that image by trying to imitate him or by trying to look like him or, you know, trying to do certain things. We're transformed into the image of Christ by beholding him, by being aware of his presence. Yes. Amen? So it's beholding Jesus that we're transformed. And it's also the power to live the life that he has given us, to operate in the power and in the authority that he's given us. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Now, we're not just talking about escaping hell here. This salvation is the whole package.
Right.
I mean, it's sozo, it's however, whatever word you want to use, but it's basically saying all your needs are met. You are complete in him. You are fulfilled in Christ. Amen? So, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God unto salvation. It's the thing that gives me the ability to operate as Christ in this world. Amen? Colossians chapter 1 and verses 5 and 6. It's the gospel of grace. It's the gospel of Christ. For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you, as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you since the day you heard it and knew the grace of God in truth. Praise the Lord. So it's when it comes unto you, as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you since the day you heard of it and knew the grace of God in truth. Praise the Lord. All right, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1 and 2. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received and wherein you stand, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain, or believed without a cause, or believed without a reason to believe. Amen? So, which also you have saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. Praise the Lord. So it says the gospel isn't just what we received, but it's the power in which we stand and by which we continue to stand or continue to be saved. It isn't like you get saved over and over and over and over, but the resources of salvation are healing and deliverance and prosperity. That's all part of your inheritance. But you can't access that, amen, on a regular basis unless you stand, amen, in that truth, unless you stand in the power, amen, by which Christ has made it available to us. Praise the Lord. So it's not just, we get confused sometimes and we think that this is all about faith to escape hell or faith to get to heaven, amen. But even our faith is a gift of God. It's by his faith, amen, that all of this takes place. The power to walk by faith is sourced in the grace of the gospel. You don't have power to walk in faith without God's grace. It's his faith.
Yes. Yes.
Praise the Lord. That's what I'm talking about. The just shall live by faith. I don't know that we even totally understand what faith is sometimes. We think it's just, you know, you just gut it out and tough it out and just really focus and I'm going to believe. It's just trusting God's faith. Trusting in the faith that made all this possible. If Jesus hadn't had the faith to go to the cross, believe in the resurrection, believe the Father was going to raise him up, believe that God would honor his sacrifice and deal with all sin, if he hadn't had the faith, it wouldn't make any difference how much faith we had.
Right.
It's believing in the faith of Christ. It's believing in what he's already done can bring this to pass in our lives. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 15:2 says, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. So keep in memory what we have attained. Back to what Paul said in Philippians 3, right? That should be the focus, what we've got, what we have in Christ, amen? Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 through Philippians 4, 1. It's only like three scriptures, I think. Philippians 3, 20 through verse 1, 4, 1. Did I totally confuse you there? I think it's 23, something like that. It's 21, yeah, okay. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Look at this for just a minute. Who shall change our vile body? Shall. That's future tense, right?
Yes.
I still got a vile body. Y'all got a vile body. All God's children got a vile body if they're still on this planet. And I'm saying that for a reason, but we'll move on here a minute. So therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, and long for my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Stand fast in the Lord. Why? Amen? Because we have an external form here, a body that has not been changed. We confuse that with the fact that we have been born again. We're born again, but our spirit man is what got born again. This body, we're still waiting for the resurrection of the body. We're still waiting for the body that is like Christ, that is without sin, the body that matches our spirit. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
So you got some baggage. I mean, if you're still on this planet, you got some stuff you're dealing with, and it's because you have a body that has not been conformed to the glorified body of Christ. You have a spirit that has been transformed, that has been born again, that is exactly like Jesus, exactly like the risen Christ. Amen. But a body that contradicts that constantly. And that's why the external is something we got to get over.
Yeah.
We got to get past the external and stay focused on the internal if we're ever going to see the external change. Praise God. Yeah. It won't happen because we're trying to make it happen. It happens because we are resting in the finished work of the cross. We are resting in who we are, what our identity is in Christ. And then the natural flow of that, with that understanding, the natural flow of that is you'll begin to walk in Christ. You'll actually be operating in Christ so that Christ could be revealed. Praise God. It's about understanding who we are in Christ. Not who we are because we got saved, but who we are in Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
He shall change this external body, but he hasn't changed it yet. What the Bible repeatedly tells us to do, and what Paul says in the final verses of Philippians 3, is to find who we are, not in the external, but who we are in the internal. He's telling us, you ain't got the body yet. You don't have a glorified body. You've got the same body you had coming into this world, a fallen body, a body that is subject to the sensor realm. But you have a spirit that is greater, that understands greater things, greater knowledge. And in Christ, you can conform, be conformed to Christ even with this body. But you have to be in Christ to do it. Praise the Lord. Instead of defining ourselves based on what we do or what we don't do, the gospel is constantly reminding us of what Christ has already done, what Jesus has completed, the finished work. Amen? Our spirit is a finished work. Our flesh, not so much. It's still going to have to go the way of all flesh unless the Lord comes sooner and raptures us out of here. It's going to die.
Come on.
That may be revelation to some of you, younger especially, but the older you get, the more that reality begins to set in, praise the Lord. But the good news is this, you're going to get a glorified body. You're going to get a body that matches your spirit. And that's when it talks about all of creation groans for the manifestation of the children of God or the sons of God. Our spirit man is longing for this glorified body so that it can be one again. Right now we're like schizophrenic. We got the spirit, but we got a body that doesn't want to cooperate most of the time. That's why we've got to be in Christ in order for anybody, anything of any significance, to be manifested in this world. Praise the Lord. When we go outside of Jesus, now I want you to listen to this. When you get outside of Christ, trying to determine the substance of your identity, you are engaged in idolatry. That's uncomfortable for all of us, praise the Lord. But it's a fact. When you try to establish your own righteousness outside of Christ, it's called idolatry in the Bible. Meaning, I will not be defined by God. I'll define myself. My culture will define me. My family will define me. My intellect will define me. My bank account will define me. Something is going to define me besides God. Now, it sounds all religious and even spiritual to some degree that I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. Look, back up a minute. Who died for you? Paul dealt with this back in the first century church. He said, one guy says, hey, I'm of whoever it was, Cephas, or I'm of Cleopas, or I'm of whoever the guy was, the two different people that were out there that had their own ministry going on, and these people are already dividing themselves up and saying, I'm of Benny Hinn, I'm of this guy, I'm of that guy, I'm of Nathan, which I haven't heard much of that, but I'm just saying, right? Praise the Lord. And Paul said, I thank God I didn't baptize any of you people, because I didn't die for you. If you're going to follow me, he said, just follow me as I follow Christ. If I deviate from that, quit following.
Exactly.
Praise God. Jesus. Philippians chapter 3 again, verses 18 through 20. We're staying right around that 20 there because it's powerful. 18 through 20, yeah. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of God, or cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, Paul urges us to remember the life into which we were called. Mm-hmm. Jesus, to whom we were united, and the place where our real identity and citizenship exists. We are aliens on this planet.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We are in the world, but we're not of the world. Yep. We're not subject to the same demands as someone who's not born again. But in order for that to be a reality, we have to remember that our conversation is in heaven, where we also look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Spirit. In other words, Paul says, remember where you came from and to who you're connected with, who you're united to. Because that's where your true identity rests. If your conversation is based on spiritual truth, you're not bound to natural facts. If we live as if this world is it, this world is what we get. Praise the Lord. Colossians 3. Verse 3, having begun in the Spirit, we know this, we've talked about it, but if you're dead, your life is hid with Christ in God. Now, he's talked to these people about in Galatians how they were still, they were saved. It was a spiritual experience that they had when they were born again, when Christ, the hope of glory, came into their lives. And then they act as though, okay, he came, he saved me, and then he went away, and now it's up to me. I got to really get focused on this and really got to get it together. Amen. And Paul said, look, that ain't how it started. That's not the way it works. Amen. And so here in Colossians, he says basically the same thing. He said, you're dead. Your life is hid with Christ in God. So the same thing that we're struggling with, the same body, the same flesh, this same sensory kind of machine is dead. Your flesh, your life is hid in Christ. That's why God sees you as a spirit. He doesn't see you as flesh. He sees you as spirit. That's the only way he can see you. Amen. Because in Christ, amen, he sees the spirit. Amen. The person of Jesus Christ. We focus on the flesh. God isn't focused on the flesh. That's why he's telling us this isn't about what you're doing for me. It's what I've already done for you that has made you accepted in the beloved. It's hard for us because everything in this life is about this. In the natural realm, everything is about the flesh. I mean, just turn on the TV. Good night. That's all there is. This thing, that deal, nothing wrong with you know, treating the temple with respect. Just don't forget, it's just the temple. It's not God. It's just the temple in which God is dwelling, praise the Lord. So if we live like the world is all there is, then the world's all we get. If we understand the focus is to be on Christ, amen, the resurrection, then we've been crucified with Christ. We no longer live, so we don't have to be held accountable. We don't, in the sense of our own shame and guilt, doesn't have to be an issue. We can move past it. People that have dysfunctional behavior, it's generally because of their own problems. I mean, it isn't like, let me just let you in on a little story here. True, but it's kind of awkward and weird. The people that live next door over here, the guy was he was a jerk. Sorry, but he was. And he wasn't born again, and he didn't want to be born again. He just wanted to tell me about my failure as being born again, which he loved to do, along with other things that he would call me, besides not being a Christian, because I asked him, well, then, can you define this for me? Well, it's not you, you know. We had all kinds of problems, and I won't go into all of it. It's just one thing after another, and blah, 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 blah. And I tried to work with the guy, and I did everything I could. Finally, I just said, I'm done. I'm through. Called the cops. They come, made him move his junk out of here that he wouldn't do just by me politely asking him to, even telling him he could park there during the week as long as it wasn't when we had services. But the more I tried to reach out to him, the more he took advantage. You could say, well, Nathan, you're thinking about you. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. I'm still flesh and blood. Amen? And at some point, I got other things to look after besides just his attitude. I got to have a place for people to park. And if he doesn't care, then I got to do something to get it done, right? Well, short of having a fist fight out here in the parking lot, which I thought would have been great for publicity, but probably not so great for the church. Amen. So I called the police, and they talked. And, of course, he was very polite and willing to do it because it was the police. A week later, now, I knew there would be repercussions. I didn't really care, but I just knew that there would be because I dealt with this guy for a year and a half. But there weren't any repercussions because he had his parole revoked and went back to prison. Now, am I excited about that and happy about that? No, because that isn't what I was asking for.
Right.
I just didn't want the hassle anymore.
Right.
Trying to reach out to him, doing things for him, and just getting slapped in the face every single time. So we're still trying to. Mike has dealt with the young lady and kids, and I'd given the kids money, had them help me weed just to have something, you know, just to keep them occupied so they weren't tearing the building apart. I had an ulterior motive, but, you know, so just kind of trying to be a good guy, you know, just trying to be a normal person, right? Well, in the meantime, we get another neighbor over here on this side. And he decides all last winter to push the snow from his driveway up into our yard, right out here, tearing up the sod, piling up snow. I mean, who does this? I mean, would you do that to your neighbor? Not for very long, I'll bet you. I never said anything. I figured we'll just let this chill out. I'll deal with him next spring. We'll get to meet him and talk to him and spend a little more time, and then maybe we can kind of sort this all out. So I didn't say anything, although it did tick me off, I got to tell you, especially when I started mowing this spring and had to, it was like mowing a plowed field out there where they had dug everything up with the blades. Well, then, on top of this, all this same time, they're parking their vehicles in front of the mailbox. So I can't get my mail. When I get the mail has like 5 dates on it when the mailman had tried to deliver it, but he couldn't because the mailbox was blocked. So I put a note on the vehicle and just said, you know, I'd appreciate it if you could park front or back of the mailbox so that I can get my mail. Appreciate it. Thank you, Nathan. Just left it like that. It was like then they pulled up on me, you know.
Yep.
Every single day it was like that. Couldn't no mail half the time. The mailman would come. If he saw me out here, he'd come in and give it to me. Otherwise, I wouldn't get the mail for maybe a week at a time. So I'm out here mowing Thursday, and the guy that owns the house, who I happen to know, who's he's a guard at the Polk County Jail. And he came over and he said, Nathan, what's going on? I said, nothing, man, what's up? I thought he'd sold the place. And he said, well, the people moved out over here. And I said, oh, they did, because I'd noticed there wasn't any vehicles in front of my mailbox for 2 or 3 days. And I said, well, that's too bad for you, but not so bad for me, because I've been hassling with these people for the last year. I said, they keep parking their vehicle in front of the mailbox all the time. And he said, that red truck? And I said, yeah. And he said, oh, well, he's back in prison. In the meantime, they had broke back into the house, tore out a bunch of electrical stuff in the basement, and damaged a bunch of plumbing, and tried to steal the refrigerator. They got as far as the front door before they realized they probably weren't going to be able to carry it out and put it in the back seat of their car. I'm guessing they may have been a little high when they made that decision, and kind of things came to them as they went on. Now, here's my point. God didn't send this guy to prison. He didn't send that guy to prison. And he sure didn't send him to prison because he was trying to do something for me, or he was going to get even for them being bad to me. They reaped what they sowed. But because I didn't take the thing into my own hands, even as although some may think I did over here, I didn't, believe me, I didn't do what I wanted to do. I did what I felt like was probably the best thing I could do under the circumstances without, you know, letting him know I was serious, but yet not creating an issue. Like I said before, sometimes I forget how old I am. I'd have found out real quick how old I was if I'd have pushed that too far. Praise the Lord. So I'm just saying, because I trusted God, even though I really wasn't trusting God completely, God dealt with the issue himself. He didn't make them go to jail. They chose that. That was their choice. But God was going to resolve the thing because I trusted God to resolve it. Whether that meant us being able to work together through this thing and make it all sort out, or the fact that they've just scattered to the four winds. Praise the Lord. I'm not telling you everybody that crosses you is going to end up in prison any more than I'm saying that's what happened in this case. But I am saying God will fight the battle if you will let him fight the battle. The challenge is to remember that we are in Christ. And if we trust in that identity, in that reality, it will make the crooked places straight. It'll bring the high places low and the low places up. It'll even out the situations that you're involved in. Amen? And only Christ can do that. If we're not focused on Jesus, believe me, you're going to get focused on you or the crisis, and something ugly will happen. Amen. And that's what I told the cops when I called them. I don't really want this, but this thing's going sideways right now. And I know it because I've already dealt with the guy. And I'm out here pulling weeds that day, and he's standing over there in his driveway, you know, cursing me while I'm trying to pull weeds while his vehicle's sitting in the middle of the parking lot. Praise the Lord. So when I called the cops, I just said, look, I want something done. I want something done now. I'm not trying to be a jerk. But this thing is getting stupid, and it's going to go south, and I don't want to be having to stand down there in court dealing with this thing. I'd rather get it dealt with right here and right now. So it was.
Right.
Amen? But all of me wanted to be as ignorant as I've ever been in my life. I don't know if it was fear or confidence in God. But it turns out that God work the whole situation out. Now, I'm saying, unless we trust in our identity in Christ, we're left with us and our identity. Praise the Lord. If this world defines us, this world is all you're going to get. But if you are defined by Christ, being in Christ, then there is no limit to what God can do in your life and through your life. But without a focus on that reality and that identity, we're just people waiting to die so we can go to heaven. We're no different than anybody else. Amen?
Amen.
In this life, unless we have hope in Christ, unless we are focused in Christ, we're miserable. We're more miserable than the people that aren't saved, at least in this life. Because they don't care. Now, it'll be a whole other ball game once we pass from this life to the next. But God wanted to bring that life to this life. Not wait for us to get to it, but he was going to bring it to us. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Being found in Christ is the key to everything. But without that focus, without that identity, it's just verbiage. I mean, it's just language. Praise God. Colossians chapter 3:3, did we do that? For you are dead, your life is hid with Christ in God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. See, we're people united to Christ, hidden with him in God. And you've got to remember who you are, because doing flows from being.
Yeah.
Doing doesn't flow from knowing. It flows from being.
Come on.
Are you with me?
Yep.
If you are in Christ, stuff happens. Doing will flow from who you are, from your being. It doesn't flow from you having intellectual knowledge. It doesn't flow just because the Bible says it. Amen? The fruit flows from who you are in Christ. Amen? In knowing who you are in Christ, in being who you are in Christ, it flows from being. Praise God. Philippians chapter 3, again, verses 8 through 11. Philippians 3, 8 through 11. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung or garbage, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection. Praise the Lord. So Paul says, if you're going to pursue righteousness, Pursue Jesus. Amen? If you're going to pursue healing, pursue Jesus. If you're going to pursue deliverance, pursue Jesus. So we go pursuing a deliverance ministry when Jesus is the deliverer. We go pursuing somebody, there's all these, what do they call them now? Life coaches. I don't need a life coach. Praise the Lord. I have got the life.
Yes.
I just need to know that life. Amen? I'm not against, you know, people helping people. I'm just saying. This is what he's trying to get us to understand. I need to be conformed to him, and the only way that happens, amen, is by beholding him, by focusing on him. So don't let looking good or being better be your goal. Let the goal be Jesus. Don't make the goal deliverance ministry, prosperity, healing. Make the goal Jesus, and all of that comes. It's seek ye first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. We're going after the things, trying to get God to work it out for us, instead of going after God and just letting them happen the way they will happen if we are in Christ, if that's where our identity is found. I mean, since Jesus is infinite, how many of you know that?
Amen.
Without beginning, without end, amen? He's infinite. Because he's infinite, there's always going to be more to him to be had. More of him to be had. You understand what I'm saying? You're not going to get to the end of Jesus. Not in this life, not ever. He's infinite. Praise God. There's always going to be deeper places to go in Christ. There's always going to be more revelation, but it's in Christ. Not in the peripheral, but in him we live and move and have our being. Amen? So, Paul says, don't get led astray by legalists. And don't get caught up in secondary pursuits. Know him. Praise the Lord. Listen, if you know him, you know plenty. Praise the Lord. And the more you know of him, the more everything else makes sense. Praise God.
Yep.
Philippians 2, verse 12. We're talking about pressing into Jesus. That's what it is, but it's pressing into the dominion of Jesus. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. That used to freak me out. That either you're saved or you're not saved, right? Nobody wants to make a commitment there either. I get it. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Why? Because Paul knows that pressing the dominion of the gospel into deeper depths, into the hidden recesses of our hearts and our lives, involves dying. Dying to me. Amen. He's already told me I'm crucified, but I got a problem giving up the ghost here. Because I'm so focused on this and behavior and attitudes and so on. I mean, I can't tell you. I've talked to the Lord a lot about these things. Because I wasn't happy with the way I'm feeling about it. Now, I wasn't doing everything that I was feeling, but I was still feeling. It's just like we were talking about this morning. You know, you're driving along and you're thinking, man, I just want to, that guy is just trying to get to me this morning. I mean, I don't know what his problem is, why he keeps cutting me off, and he's back and forth, he's up and down, he's slamming on the brakes, gets in front of me. Then the guy behind me is riding my back bumper. I got all these peeves, all these issues, you know, and I'm just mad, and I just, man, I just want to pull up the next light, get out, pull out that 9mm Ruger, and just bang, 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 bang. Now, everybody, I got your attention. Drive light. Drive like me. Right, Sally? I never pulled a gun. But I mean, I got to tell you, there's been times where the thought actually came through my mind. These people, the only way to settle this is kill somebody. I mean, they're not taking this serious. Okay, so I'm exaggerating a little bit here. But my point is this. The feeling, I've already had the feeling. I've already got the attitude. And just because I didn't act on it doesn't mean I'm not guilty of it. Because Jesus said, if you look on a woman. No, I have been unfaithful. But I've looked at some women because I got these. And I only wear these to see. Praise the Lord. Right? He said, if you hate somebody, you're a murderer.
Right.
I got to say, there's been times, there's been some hate in me. I didn't pull the gun. I didn't pull the trigger. I didn't raise the club. But I had that feeling. I had that, this is, you know. Praise God. So Paul is saying, pressing the dominion of the gospel into the deepest depths of our reality, of our being, of our hearts, of our lives, involves dying so that Christ might live. Misunderstanding faith puts all of the weight on our conversion,
mm-hmm,
with very little expectation for what comes afterwards.
Right.
And sadly, that's where a lot of the church is, even to this day.
Exactly.
We're just, if we're working out our salvation, we think we're working out so that we can get to heaven quicker or have a better mansion or a bigger mansion or more rewards or something than somebody else has. Hebrews 6, verse 1. I'm about done here. One more scripture after this. Hebrews 6 and 1. See, typically we would talk about how wonderful I am so that you'd feel bad about yourselves. Get your act together and get straightened out. Well, I like to just tell you the truth about me. That way you leave here feeling better about yourself. Praise the Lord. Amen. I'm just being honest. And this isn't humility. It's just true. My wife sits right here. I'd be the biggest hypocrite in the world if I stood up here and told you what a wonderful, perfect human being I am. I'm really pretty good. I'm almost there. But she's holding me back. Because she knows. She knows. She knows. I can't get free of the truth. Praise God. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. So leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, which is in Christ. Okay, it's one thing to be connected to Christ or to be aware of Christ or to have a saving knowledge of Christ. But he says, we need to move on here at some point. This isn't just about being saved. It isn't just about being converted from death to life in the spirit realm. But it's about also dying to that flesh. And it's about coming, amen, into Christ. Leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection in Christ. Not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith toward God. God wants us to grow in Him. Amen. He wants us to grow from being infants in Christ to being mature in Christ. You can't do either one outside of Christ. Praise God. Colossians chapter 3, verses 3 and 4. You say, well, you're confusing me with this being in Christ, being born again, being saved. No, I'm just saying it's a way that we live our life. I'm not saying you're not saved, but I'm saying you could be saved and not operating in Christ. Why? Because your focus is everywhere else. They may be good. The focus may be on good things, you know, things that you're doing, things that you're trying to do, things that you're trying to accomplish, but it doesn't keep you in Christ in a way that it's going to be life-altering. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. When Christ, who is our life, that's pretty definitive there, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Verse 10. And have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Now I'm saying this. We don't just want the fruit of knowing the information of the gospel. But we want the fruit of having lived a life captured by the gospel. Being found in him. That's the true fruit. I don't want fruit of the flesh because it's going to get me nothing more than what I've already got. I want the fruit of the Spirit. And the only way you can really have that is by what? Abiding in the vine. By being in Christ. By being focused on it's all about him. He's the fruit producer. I'm just the branch that the fruit hangs on. If I can abide in him, I get recognition. I don't deserve any recognition. I'm just a branch. Right? He deserves all the recognition. He deserves all the glory. He's producing the fruit. But if I abide in him, he gives me the luxury, if you will, and the honor of bearing witness that I'm in him and that he's in me. Fruit is produced automatically. We've got fruit trees, a couple of fruit trees. I get up really early in the morning sometimes, and I've trimmed those trees. I've never heard them once say, ouch, or, man, I hope we get some fruit on us this year. No. It just happens. Amen? Unless I chop them loose from that root, they're going to keep producing. Some years more than other years, but they always produce. And they always produce after their own kind. Cherry tree has yet to put on an apple. Right. Apple tree has never put on a cherry. Right. Not in our yard. Amen? Yep. He is the vine. He is the reality. He is the life. Without the vine, there's no life. Kill the root, the tree will be dead in no time. But I've got trees out there that I've cut back. A birch tree. Limbs were dead all over this thing. And it wasn't that big of a tree. Sally said, cut it down. I said, oh, I think maybe. She spots dead trees all the time. They're everywhere. She sees dead trees everywhere. Praise the Lord. But I cut that thing back to where it looked almost like a shrub. It's about 20 foot tall now with limbs all over it. And like they belong there, you know, leaves and everything else. Because the root was still good. The limbs were bad, but the root was still good. It's still producing. It's still putting life into that tree. The tree continues to grow. That's what I'm saying about Jesus. If we stay focused to him, amen, keep him the main thing. And the next thing you know, you're producing fruit where there was no fruit before. Amen. Christ working through you and in you. Amen. That's the hope of glory. This isn't about escaping here and going to heaven. That'll happen in its own time. This is about bringing the one seated at the right hand of the Father to this place, into this realm. That's why he left us here. That's why we're still here, so that Christ can be found in each one of us. Amen. Amen. So that heaven can invade earth. Amen. Praise the Lord. So that healings can take place. So that deliverance can take place. All the fruit that God wants to show. It only happens if we're in him. Can you say praise the Lord? Praise the Lord. So we stay focused. It's It's not a bad thing, because all the heavy lifting's been done. He took all the guilt, he took all the shame, he took all the punishment, he did all the work. All we got to do is stand in the pay line. Praise the Lord. You just tell guys all the time in the Marine Corps, when I was getting out, new guys come and try to tell you everything. I'd say, look, man, I got more time in the pay line than you have in the chow line. So don't come try and tell me how this works, you know, how it happens, praise the Lord. Well, that's the way with us. We need to realize we have more time in this relationship with Jesus than eternity can measure. If you understand what I'm saying. Because it isn't about time. It isn't about us. It's about Him. It's about what He has done. And if we abide in Him, we're just standing in the pay line. Amen? We're just waiting to get paid again, to get blessed again, to get the favor of God revealed again in us.
Yes, Lord.
This world needs to see legitimacy. Doesn't, I mean, they need to know. When I talk to these people, you know, I say, look, man, I haven't always been a pastor. So if you think, you know, that I don't understand the language you're speaking, man, I coined some of those words. You're not going to shock me with your behavior. Praise the Lord. I come from the same planet. I was just birthed in another realm.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
So God is our protector, our provider. He's everything. Then it only makes sense that we would want to abide in Him and not this. I don't want to be an idolater. I don't want to believe that I define me. You don't want to know me. You don't want to know what I would define me as in just in the natural. Amen? But we are all more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. One of the biggest problems in the world, I'm not psychoanalyzing anything other than this. One of the biggest issues with psychosomatic problems and psychological issues is self. And here's how psychology teaches to deal with it. Just do whatever you want. Don't feel guilty. Just do whatever you want. Told my sister-in-law, not my wife's sister, my brother's wife, brother's ex-wife. She called my mother up one time, just years ago, and just started cussing a blue streak. And I mean not just, you know, kind of gray area swear words. I mean filth, stuff that, you know, you wouldn't hear drunken men say. It was just really ugly stuff. And my mom said, whoa, wait a minute. What is the matter? And she said, well, I talked to my psychiatrist, and he just told me, I just need to say whatever comes into my head. I just need to get it off, get it out of me. That's the world's answer, amen, to our fallen condition. And Jesus is saying, look, in me, you're perfect. You're righteous. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to unload all your baggage on everybody else. I've already taken all your baggage. You can be free to be yourself and not be stupid about it. Praise the Lord. Because He's paid the price for all of it.
Amen.
Amen. We don't have to vent every time we feel like venting. Amen. We don't have to flip out just because we can flip out.
Right.
We can be more than conquerors.
Yes.
The way we are more than conquerors is through Christ.
Yes, Lord.
He makes me victorious over the situation, including myself.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
It's easy. It's uncomplicated. It's only complicated when we start mixing all the religious attitudes and ideas that we've had over the years and try to force them into this paradigm, into this truth. If we would just back off, focus on Him and trust Him and believe that He is always with me, will never forsake me, will never leave me, always leads me to victory, then I can stay focused on Him instead of on this. And I can truly say, I'm crucified with Christ,
amen.
Yet I live, but it's not me that lives. It's Christ in me. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. Amen, amen. So don't give up on Revelation. Just don't get so quick to want the next one without embracing the one that we have. I believe it's like anything else. We can distort it all if we don't totally immerse ourselves in the what we have before we try to leap to the next. Amen?
Amen.
I promise you, if you will live your life in Christ, you'll have more revelation and you know what to do with.
Amen.
He'll just keep taking you deeper and deeper and deeper, revealing more and more and more of Him and thereby you at the same time.
Amen.
Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate your patience this morning. Have a great week. Just keep remembering, I'm in Christ. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.
I just got
hold it up just a second for Mike.
I just got a message from Myron. He's looking for a couple or two people to pick him up at the hospital and let him out. One person needs to drive him home. Another person needs to take his car and